So far, we have discussed about machinery, condition monitoring in the sense signal processing, and then how through vibration monitoring we are able to find out faults in mechanical systems. Now we will begin the module 4 of this course, wherein we will be discussing the other techniques of machinery condition monitoring, that is normally the wear debris analysis as it is known as. And then we have the other condition monitoring techniques like the motor current signature analysis and how non-destructive tests, NDT techniques like ultrasonics, radiography, acoustic emission are also thermography are also used to find out faults in machines. Usually about 70% of the cases are in condition monitoring are through vibration analysis. And universally throughout surveys in the industry, it has been found that usually the other 20% actually belongs to this category, which we will be discussing in today's lecture on contaminant analysis and then the subsequent lecture on oil analysis. How basically we analyze the oil, the lubricating oil and the debris which are deposited in them, by examining them we can find out whether the machine is deteriorating fast or slow and so on. So, I will be discussing on contaminant analysis. As you know, the tribology is a study of friction, lubrication and wear in mechanism or machines. For example, when we have two machine members interacting with each other, there is a normal force onto them, and these surfaces may not be smooth as I showed you in the case of the bearings. They may have a surface roughness, and usually once these two components rub against each other because the application of load, we actually put a layer of lubricant. So, the purpose of this lubricant is to reduce the friction. I have to reduce friction, because reduction of friction between two meeting machine members means that the forces or the power consumed to move them will reduce because of the friction. Friction can be reduced by closing this asperities in these surfaces by having this lubricants here. But in the process, what happens? These particles here also wear out, because of loading, because of abrasion, so on. And these particles wear particles get deposited. They get deposited in the lubricating oil. So, two very important things happen because of this process in any machine. So, this happens in any or every machine meeting members. Example, gears meeting, shaft and a bearing, could be bush, could be journal, could be anti-friction. So, when two materials meet against each other, they rub against each other, there will be a lot of heat generation, and because one may be softer than the other, so it's going to wear out. Like when you have an eraser rubbing on a piece of writing, you know, those rubber flakes peel off the eraser. Okay, so what happens is two important things happen. Number one, because of such a process, the wear particles, or which we call them as the contaminants, get deposited in the oil. Okay. So, the concentration of the wear particles, the nature of the wear particles, the rate at which they have been deposited in the oil gives us some clue as to what is wrong with the parent material from which they have worn out, because of maybe excessive load, because of less lubrication, because of temperature effects. So, these are factors which are responsible for the wearing out of these particles from the mating members. Okay. Now, understanding where these wear particles came off from, we can know whether the parent material was maybe poorly designed, was of a softer material, did not have proper heat treatment, was not lubricated, was subjected to higher temperature. So, these are the scenarios which we need to investigate, and then also knowing from the chemical composition of the wear particles, if it has, say for example, if it has come out of a general bearing, if you see a lot of zinc or tin or lead, we know this bearing is wearing out faster than it is supposed to be. So, this gives us indication as to why and how or how quickly the machine is deteriorating. And the next, of course, happens is once these wear particles get deposited in the oil will undergo a change. In its physical and chemical properties, because the virgin oil, I mean the oil which was new and which has not been used in machine, it has certain physical properties like its density, like its viscosity, like its oxidation number, etcetera. So, once these contaminants get deposited in the oil, these properties are going to change. Okay. These properties change. So, if somebody monitors these properties, we will know that something has gone wrong with the machine. It is very similar. So, this contaminant analysis, which we are going to discuss in today's lecture and in the oil analysis in the subsequent lecture, basically they are like pathological tests which we do when we go to the doctor, okay, like we do an urine analysis or in a blood sample analysis. Okay. Similarly, for the machines, we also need to look into this wear particles and oil analysis. Okay. Now, throughout the world, worldwide, I should tell that again, 70% of CBM, condition based maintenance, is done through vibration monitoring, and these are from statistical information which is available in the literature. And usually 20% is what is known as the wear and debris analysis, which is essentially nothing but the contaminant analysis, and oil analysis. Okay. And the remaining 10% is other techniques and that makes it 100%. So in this other techniques, I have what is known as the motor current signature analysis. Then we have what is known as the thermography. Then we have the ultrasonics. Some of them are the non-destructive test techniques like X-ray or radiography, acoustic emission. Then we have dye penetrant test. Then we have boroscopy, etcetera. Okay. These are the non-destructive NDT. So, this form about 10% of the CBM throughout the world. Recently, what has happened, this motor current signature analysis has become a leading technique in finding out CBM. And we in IIT Kharagpur have done some of the pioneering research in motor current signature analysis to basically find out faults in mechanical systems using the current drawn by the electrical motor, which is driving either the gearbox or the mechanical driven unit. And details about this research can be found in my website. And in fact, in the subsequent classes, we will be referring you to some of the experiments and literature which we have published in these areas. So, well, today, as I was telling you, we will focus more in this contaminant analysis in this class. So, with this kind of an preview, let us see what is this contaminant analysis we are going to talk about. So, as you will see here, the contaminants or the wear debris have certain characteristics. One is the quantity. Of course, if the quantity is high in a given composition, usually they are measured in parts per million. See, this wear debris are measured in ppm, parts per million. Okay. And if you will know, if you go back to the familiar bathtub curve, what is going to happen is you have the infant mortality zone and then the uniform failure rate, and then towards this end you have this wear out zone. Okay. And what happens suddenly at a given time, if you see that the wear debris parts have increased, are increasing with time, you know that the defect severity has increased. Okay. So, in the laboratory where you do the contaminant analysis, by the way, this contaminant analysis etcetera cannot be done in situ, that means next to the machine. Like when you have vibration monitoring, you just put a vibration transducer next to the machine and record the signal and do an analysis and tell where the fault is. In contaminant analysis or in oil analysis, you cannot do that. All is, you have to collect the oil, like we collect in blood or in urine sample, and send it to your pathological lab. Similarly, in these machines also, you have to collect the oil in which the contaminants are there, give the entire sample to a lab, wherein they will be doing the contaminant analysis, therein where they will check the severity by calculating the quantity of the particles present. For example, in every month, okay, you see the ppm of maybe zinc in a machine component. So, in the first month, end of the first month, second month, third month, 4 month, 5 month, okay. After every month, you will be collecting the oil sample and giving it to a lab, okay. And suddenly to begin with, you know, this is about, you know, 2 parts per 3 parts, maybe again 2 parts. This could happen because of measurement error. Once it is 3, then again it is coming down, but you know, 4, 5, and constantly 5, and then you see suddenly. Okay. And you see towards the end, this is when you need to be get alarmed. Because of high levels of zinc. Well, but then you may be wondering, who decides what is an alarm level? Well, this depends on many things. This depends on the machine, of course. This depends on the operating parameters. Like speed, load, temperature. Okay, the machine could be a gearbox, blower, etcetera. So, for these, there are standards, or industries have made their own standards based on their experience. They say, you know, if I get more than 15 ppm of zinc, I should be alarmed that the machine has undergone a severe failure. Okay, so this severity is actually the severity level or the alarm level is actually decided by the user himself or herself. Okay. Now, what happens? The next point is size of the particle. You know, we are getting size of the particles. You know, this wear debris are, they come in many forms. You know, one could be laminar strips, one could be irregular shaped particle, one could be spheres. Okay, some could be curled strips. Because this actually leads to the morphology of the wearer particles. But the rate is very important, because what will happen? We have some having maybe 5 micron size. Suddenly, if the surface has worn out so much that I am getting large boulders, large spheres. Good example of this is, you know, you have a fresh road, okay, nicely metal road, okay, And then initially, you know, you have a lot of loose asphalt. Okay, and with time, you will see suddenly you will get, you know, big chunks, big spears, big rocks, okay, loose asphalt, small rocks, then you have big rocks, then you will have, you know, boulders coming out. If you do not treat this road, asphaltic road, no treatment is done, with time, because of weathering conditions, you will initially have loose asphalts coming out, then the gravels and the rocks, then the big rocks, followed by boulders. Okay. Similarly, so the same thing happens in machines as well. You will have, you know, small strips coming out, small spears coming out. If it goes untreated, you will have, you know, big components coming out, big spears coming out, and so on. So the size will decide on the rate of severity of this wear debris. Okay. So with time, you will see that the particle size, maybe it was 5 microns to begin with, and then it became 20 or 10 microns, and so on. Next is the morphology, the mode is whether the shape is laminar, like strips, whether it is curled, whether it is spear, whether it is irregular. You must have noticed this while you do machine in the laboratory, in the workshop, when you use a lathe machine. To machine surfaces, okay, the chip morphology tells us regarding the type of machining. I am sure all of you must have seen while you machine a mild steel specimen, you will get curl chips. Okay, when you have cast iron, you will get broken steel pieces. There is no continuous strip here, but here you will get broken steel. So, this tells us about the operation. Of course, you know, here we are making it happen, but in machines, because of wear and tear, we will get these particles coming out. So, some particles could be like a spear, some particles could be like a strip, some particles could be like a spear, some particles could be curled, okay, curved. Some particles may be having a lot of holes on them, and so on. So, depending on the morphology of this worn out particles, you know, of course, you know, we cannot see them in our naked eyes. So, we need to use optical microscope to begin with. Okay. And then we have to magnify them to see them. Okay. And then the most important part is the composition of the wear debris particles. The composition of these wear debris particles will tell us what is the parent material in terms of the composition, whether it is, you know, lot of iron, lot of zinc, lot of chromium, lot of sulfur, lot of silicon. Okay. We know, for example, a good example is silicon. Okay. The sand grains or the dirt actually have silicon, silica. Suddenly, in the contaminants, I find a lot of silicon or sand grain coming up, I will know that means lot of foreign dirt has gone into my machine. Okay. So, these are little size. If I know the parent composition of the material and I know that in my wear particles, a certain element's composition is increasing, I know in a given machine from where this particle has come out and which component in this machine is deteriorating. That knowledge will be known to me. So, this wear mechanisms are many. Okay. For example, when the particles are meeting, one may adhere to another because of temperature, because of load, and then because of rubbing, they may try to pull out a surface of this material. There could be a lot of abrasion because one is hard, other is soft, they could be using as an abrasive. Okay. And this abrasive happens in normal machines, not that this is bad. This happens, only thing is that whether the rate at which they are happening is more, whether I could do something to arrest them. For example, if you think of a journal bearing, if your abrasion is so, because usually the bearing, journal bearing, the inner liners are much softer than the shaft material. So, in process of operation, this shaft being a hard surface is going to wear out the inner bearing surface. Now, imagine if this inner bearing surface is wearing out faster, the bearing's clearance is going to increase. Now, this clearance increases, you know, the Zn by P, that is going to change. And then the from the Sommerfeld equation, you will see that the load carrying capacity of the bearing is going to reduce. So, some machines are designed, of course, you know, one machine, one component will be hard, another will not be hard. But that does not mean that abrasion wear will not take place. In normal times, abrasion wear will take place. Only thing is that we should be worried that the rate of abrasion is not excessive, so that it creates a condition wherein my bearing clearance has increased and this bearing is not able to sustain the load which is given to it. Okay. And of course, in other delamination occurs and fatigue because of the load reversal or the load cycles, fatigue kind of wears happen. And another important thing is corrosion or oxidation occurs because of an environment, this corrosive things can happen. And electrical attack happens particularly when there is a electrical loop or the ground voltage going through a machine, and because of this lubricating oil, you know, this electrical attack actually happens. Particularly think of the case of an electrical motor. Okay. And there is a rotor, this gear is a rotor, of course, there is a stator, I am not drawing the stator here. What happens, because of this, there is always a small amount of voltage loop which is going on. Okay. Now, at this interface, there is a lubricant, either if it is a journal bearing or a ball bearing, there is a thin layer of lubricant between the inner races, outer races, etcetera. Okay. And this actually is actually a dielectric. So, when I am bringing in a voltage across a capacitor, okay, and this is the dielectric. If this dielectric breaks, this voltage is going to get passed through. Okay. So, this intermittent passing of this EMF will create a spark, because there is a potential. So, this sparking comes with high energy of heat, momentarily heat. So, this is going to produce a lot of pitting on the surface, pitting on the bearing surface. I will show you in the next class some pictures of what happens when this bearing spit. So, a lot of pitting marks will come on the walls of the inner race or the outer race because of an electrical discharge going through this circuit. Okay, the usual way to avoid it is, you know, have a good grounding. If you ground it, this does not happen. I will show you some. So, but then these are responsible for the initiation of the pitting, and if this goes, once the surface has got pitted, because of load and temperature, they are weakened, and then with time, there this small pitting will be will become large, and scowling will occur, and then lot of large chunks of data, the material are going to get eroded. So, surface are going to get worn out again. So, one has to be very careful when designing electrical motors, or particularly when you have high voltage electricals in your machineries, wherein there are parts in which there are lubricant, and then when there is a discontact. We may not get an voltage as you measure, but when they are going at high speed, because of this EMF, if the grounding is not proper, we will get this sparks, and these sparks are responsible for actually like an erosion or like an EDM, like an electrical discharge occurring. In fact, people use this high voltage sparks in electrical discharge machining to machine surfaces, but here the same EDMs may be harmful to our machines. Okay. But this wear modes, you know, when we have an initial in the infant mortality zone of the bathtub, you know, you have the usually running in wear modes because of the, maybe it was not properly aligned, maybe the surfaces were having lot of bad surface finish to agree, lot of the machined surfaces were not clean, okay, and these debris were there, which is then followed by a steady wear, and then we have the wear out towards the fag end of the life of the machine. We'll have a severe wearing out followed by pitting, and then if pitting goes unnoticed, we'll have large materials coming out, which is known as scuffing. Now, usually this wear particle types, you know, I have drawn few of them, like the laminar ones or the irregular shape or the curl shape. The typical size of this wear particles, you know, could be cutting, could be spherical. If it is rubbing, it is usually less than 15 micron. By the size, I mean, if you see under a microscope, one of the dimensions, this happens to be 15 micron. This has to be only seen through microscopes. But normally, usually we use an optical microscope. Of about 1000 magnification. So, with that we can see sizes of about, you know, maximum about 5 micron. Okay. But, and usually these wear particles are of bigger sizes, and then you will see sliding is usually 20 to 50 microns, laminar 20 to 50, and fracture is big. Severe sliding is big, 50 micron, etcetera. You can see it in an optical microscope with even 200 or 500 zoom magnification. But the wear debris particles, to understand the chemical composition, we require the wear particles will be of the order of less than 2 microns. And this is not possible by optical microscopes. This has to be seen through an SEM, scanning electron microscope. So, obviously, as I was telling you, no in situ analysis is possible, okay, in case of this wear particles, okay. So, what we do basically, there is a technique. Now, if you look at this contaminant analysis, depending on the size of the particles, we can have different modes of investigation. If the particle size is less than 2 microns, I will use what is known as spectroscopy. If it is between, you know, 5 to 30 micron, I can use what is known as the wear debris analysis. And if it is greater than 30 micron, I can use what is known as the particle count. Okay. And usually there is a method known as ferrogram or ferrography. Wherein we have iron, where particles. So, actually all these contaminants are actually deposited in oil. Basically, the lubricating oil which is there between the two mating members actually uses oil to understand these contaminants. This oil can be taken, dried in a piece of on the floor, put on a place of paper, and then with a magnetic field or a gravity field, it can be laid in such a way that the heavier particles are going to get deposited in the bottom and the top particles on the top. So, you will see a ferrogram like this on a surface like this. This could be large particles, and then toward the end it will be small particles. This is the ferrogram, and ferrogram you can measure, you can see it in a microscope and see the nature of the nature and size, and also then try to understand how severe your wearing mechanism is. Okay. So, if you look at the characteristics of wear particles in a ferrogram, usually normal rubbing wear means, you know, which occurs are like flat plates, platelets like less than 15 micron. If the wear becomes severe and sliding, you will have flat elongated particles greater than 20 microns with striations, there will be a lot of striated marks. Cutting wear, long curled strips of metal which you must have seen in your workshop. Gear wear, flat striated particles. Bearing wear, laminar platelets. Spears, small particles less than 5 microns. Black oxides indicates insufficient lubrication. Red oxides indicates water contamination. Corrosive wear becomes because of heavy concentration of fine particles. Aluminum wear, white metal particle. When there is dust or dirt, foreign particle or material not characteristic of machine or oil. So, what happens? These are the particles which we see from a macroscopic level under an optical microscope. And just only looking at the size and the shape, we can have some clue as to what kind of wear took place, what kind of contamination took place. Is it water contamination? Is it contamination with dirt or sand in your machine? This can be done. But this analysis never tells us about the chemical composition of these wear particles, whether it is made out of iron, whether how much of parts of copper is there, how much parts of zinc is there. For that, we have to do what is known as spectroscopy. Okay. Before I go into spectroscopy, I will tell you some of the wear debris analysis methods. And basically, wear debris are done for particles which are above 5 microns and beyond. So, I could see it under an optical method. I can have a light beam pass through an oil which has this wear particles, and because of the density of the wear particles increasing, this light is going to get reflected, and this can be detected by a photo detector. So, the intensity of the light reflected back gives me a clue as to how much percentage of that opaque surface of where particles are there in that oil. So, in a given milliliter of oil, I can have an estimate as to how many parts per million of solid substances are there. Filter blockage, I can have a pore or a mesh size, and then like a normal sieve, I can say, you know, 5 microns stayed back, then I can, you know, this is the parts per million of 5 microns. And if I increase the sieve size, maybe, you know, 10 microns, 20 microns and so on, I can do. Where particles can also be measured through radioactivity, through thin film sensors, like magnetic attraction is by ferrography or the gravimetric, which I just described the last slide. But to know the chemical composition of the wear particles, we have to do what is known as the spectroscopic techniques for debris analysis. These debris, and mind you, they have to be sizes less than about 2 microns, which are not possible to see obviously on naked eye, even with high power magnification, maybe 100,000x magnification, you may at most see about 5 microns, but beyond that, we have to use what is known as this fine particles. We have to use, we need not count the number of parts per million, but rather find out the chemical content of these particles. And that is done through all these techniques. And these are all specialized equipment like the atomic absorption spectrophotometer, known as AAS, atomic emission spectrophotometer AES, XRF, inductive coupled plasma ICP, DCP, EDX, etcetera. Okay. These are very, very sophisticated equipment. Each of these equipment could be costing anywhere from 50 lakhs to 2 crores, each of these equipment. So, obviously, when I have a plant with a gearbox worth only 50,000 rupees or 1 lakh rupees, it will be not economical for me to have in my plant all these machines. Okay. In fact, none of the engineering industries have these where they do regular plant operations. But to analyze or to know the condition of this machine, this oil which have been collected from their gearboxes or pumps, etcetera, has to be collected and sent to a centralized laboratory, wherein this laboratory people can do analysis using the sophisticated equipment. And I will just tell you briefly about one of them, the atomic absorption spectrophotometer. What happens is, you know, this 2 micron samples which are there, they are heated to such a high surface that we have a plasma coming out of it. Then you know E is equal to h nu, okay, from the Planck's law of radiation. And this energy which is emitted is at the wavelength or is at the frequency of the radiations of the chemical elements present in this wear particles. For example, suppose it has iron, suppose it has zinc, copper, etcetera. So, the radiation of these elements, of these atoms, electrons in an iron, if it goes to an excited state, it goes at a particular frequency. Same is true for zinc and same is true for copper. Radiation at its characteristic frequency. So, all I have to do is at that characteristic frequency, I have to measure the intensity of the radiation, and that is what is done through an atomic either absorption or emission spectrum. So, basically I have a sample which is heated and then radiations will be there. I will have another source wherein I will be giving the from a concentration, from a known concentration, so I know some x ppm, I know the amount of light intensity. So, I will see the unknown light intensity, which I will measure, which has been radiated out of this element, and then from by unitary method find out what is the ppm. So I have to know for the particular element I am trying to identify, I need to know its electromagnetic radiation frequency. Okay. So there are oil standards which are used, standard light sources are used. Used to identify the chemical elements. Okay. So typically, the elements in the spectroscopic spectrometric analysis, wear elements, these are usually iron, chromium, aluminium, copper, lead, these are the wear elements which happens, and sometimes we give certain additive elements and then these are usually the contaminants, silicon, sodium, borum and vanadium. Okay. And one, of course, we need to know in the engineering applications of machines, what are the typical wear elements in from aluminum to silicon and what is the probable origin. So, for example, if I see a lot of aluminum, I know these are the possible sources wherein aluminum is there. So, if I suppose I see chromium, these are the possible sources, could be the exhaust valves, etcetera, or shafts. And when I see silicon, I know it is ingested dirt, sand, sometimes gasket sealants, oil, antifoam, antifreeze additives. So, these will be known to us from the original designer. So, to know the material of the element and then look out for these. Sometimes in many machines which are just available to us, its material composition is not known to us. Sometimes it is a difficult thing, but with experience if you will see that, you know, usually a particular component is coming out, we can do diagnostic measures to find out where, what is the source of this material. So, this is only possible by spectrometric analysis, wherein we have copper is usually coming out of bearings, lead is also coming out of bearings and everything, of course, in the industry is made out of iron, and silver, particularly in rust pin bushings, anti-friction, silver, solder, etcetera. So, this gives us a clue as to what is the possible source of the element detected by spectrometric analysis. And usually, this is the composition of the components which are there in the machinery. One is iron, chromium, nitrogen, molybdenum, manganese, lead, copper, zinc. Usually in bearing cages, it is which has high copper and zinc, as you can see. If you have rolling element bearings, it is high iron, gears, very much iron, shafts, iron, gearbox casings. So, sometimes you will see this manganese, etcetera. And this kind of metallurgy is only available by doing a spectroscopy of a sample. So, you give me a piece of iron, it is not 100% iron. So, it will may be an iron coming out of a gears, maybe only there is chromium, there is nitrogen, there is nitrogen, high nitrogen because of the case carburizing with or nitriding, you know, the gear surfaces are hard because of the initial high levels of nitrogens are there. So, suddenly in your contaminants, if you see a high level of nitrogen, you will know, well, my gear is wearing out faster than it should be. If I see high amounts of maybe zinc, I can know it is high amount these bearings which are wearing out faster. So, these kind of clues give us an indication as to where from this materials have come out of. Okay. So, to summarize in this class on contaminant analysis, you have seen what are the different types of contaminants available. Contaminants can be distinguished in terms of their size, something less than 2 microns, we cannot see them through a very high power magnetic magnification of 1000x, we have to do spectral analysis. The spectrometric analysis is done through atomic absorption spectrophotometer or emission spectrometer, emission spectrophotometer, XRF, ICP, etcetera, wherein we get to know the chemical constituent of that worn out particles as to how much percentage of iron is there, copper is there, zinc is there, lead is there, nitrogen is there. And all we have to do is regularly in a frequent interval, we have to see the chemical composition of the wear particles. I am not asking you to rub off or scrape off a material from a nice machine, but what is already deposited in the oil which is there as a lubricant. Okay? So, then from these contaminants, we can try to get us to clue what is the parent source and why this is wearing. Next comes the size, the bigger sizes. About 5 microns or greater, we can then look into the through microscope. We can see the size shapes, whether they are laminar, whether they are spherical, whether they are curved, whether they have striation marks, whether they have irregular in shape, cut shape. So, this gives us an indication as to where the wear mode, whether it is adhesion, abrasion, whether it is corrosion, whether it is because of an electrical interference, etcetera. So, these gives us to an understanding of the wear modes. And next comes the sizes are large and then they are ferritic, we can develop ferrography and then do ferrograms. But if they are sizes more than maybe 30, 40 or 50 microns, we can just use an optical source and just do a particle count as to in a given liquid, what is the parts per million of the wear particles. Nothing to do about the the composition of the wear particles, but whether is it 50 ppm in a given ml of the liquid, is that concentration of wear particles increasing with time? If it is increasing, we need to get alarm. So, this is how the contaminant analysis helps us in identifying the severity of defects or the wear mechanism in a machine, and of course, the other sister measurement technique of this is the oil analysis, which I will discuss in the next class. Okay. And examples of contamination, just as a closer, we will have the mining. Usually, if you go to a mining, it is the stone dust, ore or water. Process plant is usually process material, dust, water. A lot of water comes in this mining process plant and quarrying, component manufacturer, ceramic, you will have a lot of clays and chemicals. So, this also gives us a clue as to what happens. Okay. Thank you.